Good evening and welcome to County Connection. I'm Tami Hildebrand, the Berks County Department of Agriculture's Executive Director. I'm here this evening to talk about an important community event that will be happening May 17th. And that is our annual tire collection. Our Department of Ag partners with the Berks County Conservation District on this event for the past 2 years. And that brings me to our guest this evening, Evan Corondi. He is here to talk about what he does at the Berks County Conservation District and how we work together on this project. So, Evan, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
Sure. Could you tell me a little bit about what you do for the Conservation District?
Sure. I am the Berks County Conservation District's Mosquito-borne disease control coordinator and education and outreach coordinator. I wear a few different hats at the district and do a lot of different things throughout the year, but my first and foremost job that I was hired for was mosquito control. Major part of mosquito control is public education as well as controlling these mosquitoes. So just to kind of give you a little bit of a rundown of what our program consists of, which will lead up into what we're here to talk about, and that's our tire collection. We must perform surveillance and see what type of mosquito population we have in an area, and not only that is what type of disease they may be carrying or the carrying capacity of the disease within the mosquito population.
Okay.
We're a public service program, so we want to keep the public safe, basically, prevent them from getting diseases such as West Nile virus, Zika virus, and many other mosquito-borne diseases that we don't hear so much about. So on a daily operations, we go out to a lot of different sites along or throughout Berks County. Mm-hmm. We have hundreds of sites located within Berks County. We won't make it to all of them in a particular season, but we do hit a nice array that kind of canvasses the county well, particularly focusing on areas of higher population. Reading City, Exeter, Wyomissing, Sinking Spring, larger populations of people equals a greater risk of them coming in contact with diseased mosquitoes.
Right.
That doesn't necessarily mean there's only diseased mosquitoes there. They are throughout the county, mm-hmm. and we do perform control and surveillance throughout the county, but we try to focus on those areas. So we look at habitat where these mosquitoes are breeding. We have a lot of natural habitat where mosquitoes can breed, such as failing retention basins mm-hmm. or catch basins, tire ruts in parks. Last year, we all know, had a very wet summer, which had habitat basically everywhere for these mosquitoes.
Right.
We have to go throughout Berks County, look for these types of mosquito breeding habitats, and control them if we do find them. Another main source of mosquito breeding habitat is artificial containers. One of the most important being the tires. Junk tires that are abandoned along roadsides, maybe on agricultural property, mm-hmm. or even just in people's backyards. One singular tire can breed thousands and thousands of mosquitoes in a single season.
Right.
So it is a major concern for us. Now, we have a difficult time of measuring the mosquito population just by simply going out there and looking at larval habitat, so we do adult surveillance as well, and this is where we can collect blood samples that these mosquitoes have taken and determine what the virus activity is within that area. Now, we are predominantly looking for West Nile virus. It's been established here for almost 2 decades now.
Okay.
That doesn't mean we're not concerned about other diseases, but that is our main focus mm-hmm. As of right now.
Mm-hmm.
When the Zika scare became apparent a few years ago in 2016, we altered our surveillance methods a little bit to focus on those types of mosquitoes.
Right.
But our day-to-day surveillance year after year is for the mosquitoes that carry West Nile virus. So some of the equipment I have laid out here is something that we use on a daily operation looking for adult mosquitoes. So this is our main focus right here. This is what we call a gravid trap.
Okay.
It's kind of some interesting parts and pieces to it. We have a busboy tray right here, you know, simply to hold a concoction of water that we have created for the mosquitoes that mosquitoes prefer. So that was, we call that gravid water because we're trying to attract gravid mosquitoes or pregnant mosquitoes.
Okay, all right.
Those females are the only mosquito, the mosquito sex that takes a blood meal. So male mosquitoes don't feed on us. They feed on pollen, dust particles, things of that nature. The male mosquito isn't actually out seeking a blood meal. Okay. It's simply the female looking for that blood meal for protein to formulate her eggs. So we, as a disease control program, want to look for only female mosquitoes. So we look for, try to replicate habitat and where they would be breeding. So that's where these gravid traps come into play. So we have the busboy tray here. We put this concoction of stinky water in here. Now I won't make you smell any of this stinky
water.
Just because it is quite rank. It's designed to be that way because mosquitoes like
water pond that ponds for a while.
Sure. You know, organic
things
water is the term
it,
I was looking for. The higher the organic matter, the better it is for their larva to feed on. So our trap is pretty basic here. You know, these things are a little beat up. They get set out day in and day out throughout the summer months. All it is on top of this busboy tray is a modified toolbox with a simple fan inside of it, a 6-volt battery to run the fan motor, and as well as a collection chamber and the tube that it goes in. So we simply take this collection chamber. Now you can see we have some different sites on there from areas throughout the county. We want to make sure we know what site that it is coming
placed
to.
In, right.
So we want to place that inside the gravid trap like that. Put that netting over there so it basically forms a seal. There's what you cannot see is the hole underneath there.
Okay,
you can see
yeah.
it coming out.
Mm-hmm. Pipe-like. Mm-hmm.
So that is where we are going to collect our mosquitoes from. So we hook up the motor here. I'll just hook it up for a second just so you can kind of hear it. Just don't want it to drown out. But there's a fan motor that will basically suck air up into this trap.
Right.
It comes in through here outside the fan right here, sucks the mosquitoes in on the trap. So,
and you have these across Berks County, placed across Berks County, and then you collect the data
on
them?
Okay. Yes. Yes.
And then from there, where does the data go?
So we actually collect the mosquitoes themselves within these collection chambers. These traps get sit out overnight because the species of mosquito that prefers to bite us and could carry West Nile virus, known as the Culex species of mosquitoes, Culex pipiens, Culex restruens, or also known as the northern brown house mosquito, they prefer to be active in the crepuscular time period, so in the early morning and in the evening time frames. Always seems that in that evening time frame is when most people are getting bit. That's because when they're most active out foraging for food.
Right.
So we set this up during the day, we allow it to run overnight, collect it the next day. So that mosquito sample is then taken back to our office.
Mm-hmm.
We divvy out the mosquitoes from other bycatch that we may collect in there. We preserve the specimens on dry ice and ship them off to the DEP laboratory in Harrisburg, where they are then identified further, counted, and tested for these diseases, mainly West Nile virus in this case.
And they let you know if there's a positive or
absolutely. So
and where that was located.
We have a good correlation in our database. All of the data that we collect from our surveillance is entered into a database linked to DEP. They send us the information back so then we can perform our control methods or other types of surveillance in those areas, you know, depending on what type of disease or viral activity we find in these areas.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then to eradicate these, is there any spraying or anything that you do? Or
we
you
do.
Let that up?
So,
okay.
We have certain thresholds that we can meet. We can have what we call a vector index.
Mm-hmm.
So we use the population of humans, as well as the number of mosquitoes we collect per trap, using a mathematical equation to decipher how much that viral activity is and the danger level, if you will, in a certain area. Mm-hmm. Once we meet those thresholds, our program calls for some type of control. So there are several methods in which ways we can do that. Mm-hmm. The way that we see most fit in most instances is a truck-mounted spray. We did this 9 times last year throughout Redding City and the surrounding areas within Berks. Mm-hmm. This puts out a very fine mist of insecticide that catches the mosquito as they're in flight, which is why we only spray in the evening time frames, because we don't want to come in contact with any type of beneficial insect, bees, and other beneficial insects that may be active during the day. So we will not apply our ULV treatments anytime besides the evening into the maybe midnight or so.
Right. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness. Okay. All right. So you did this 9 times last night.
Yes, we did this 9 times last season in 2018.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
You know, we probably would have done it more. We can't do it during the rain events and things of that nature. So the weather did hold us off from doing some more adult control.
Okay.
More predominantly, that is our last ditch effort. We really like to control mosquito populations at the larval level.
Mm-hmm.
One, by maybe applying insecticides or larvicides to the areas where they're breeding, generally many of which insecticides that we use are species specific, so they're only going to affect mosquito larvae or maybe potentially black fly larvae, but beneficial insects and other invertebrates are not affected. So that is our first step. And even before that, which kind of ties into the tire collection, is reducing habitat.
Right.
That's a major part of our program, is trying to reduce as much habitat as possible, not just through tire collections, but through maintaining basins correctly, getting the word out to the public that any water, standing water in your backyard is potential breeding grounds for mosquitoes. Most of the times when I go to a complaint call that we receive, that the habitat that I'm going to look for is going to be right in somebody's backyard. These mosquitoes do have potential to fly, mm-hmm. but for the most part, they are staying fairly local,
right.
and localized. A certain species of mosquitoes known as the Asian tiger mosquito.
Oh, which we have a picture of, a slide
of. Oh, very good.
Right now.
Very good.
You can check that out. There you go.
So the Asian tiger mosquito does have potential to carry West Nile virus, but it seems to be more of a nuisance mosquito that we run into.
Mm-hmm.
These breed in containers, so they're a prime tire breeder, as well as very small cryptic habitats. It's been known that the species similar to Asian tiger mosquito and itself can breed in water and containers as small as a bottle cap.
Oh my goodness.
So
that's scary.
If we just think of the amount of habitat that there is for them.
Right.
You know, but they do tend to be a vicious daytime biter and a very aggressive one at that. So we do try to control them on the nuisance level.
Okay. We have a next one here. You may say that word. I
sure.
don't quite know what.
So Culex pipiens, yes, or Culex restuans.
Okay.
Culex pipiens and Culex restuans look very similar.
Mm-hmm.
They are a common vector for West Nile virus. They prefer to breed, or they prefer to bite birds,
mm-hmm.
But they are a bridge vector, meaning that they will commonly bite humans as well. So that is where we get our disease transmission from and
right.
how we
okay.
are affected by West Nile.
Right.
So you can see there the life cycle of Culex pipiens. You know, after they take a blood meal, they will go and lay their egg rafts on water. Those egg rafts will hatch out into larvae. They go through 4 instar stages or growth stages before they pupate, turn into a pupal form. Now, keep in mind, they're all breathing air at this time. They have a siphon in which they poke out of the top of the water to breathe air, as well as the pupa. After that stage, they pupate into an adult where they can go out and they will breed and search for another potential blood meal and or just a mate.
Oh my goodness. They're busy.
They are.
Right. And here's the transmission that you were talking about earlier with birds.
Yes. So the birds are actually the primary vector for West Nile virus. They are carrying the West Nile virus in which the mosquito feeds on. It then therefore replicates within the mosquito itself. Mm-hmm. It generally takes about 2 weeks until it is broken down and then forms into its salivary glands. So after it does that, if that mosquito then bites a human being, it can infect that human being. We are a dead-end host for West Nile virus, meaning we can't transmit it then to another person, or mm-hmm. A mosquito feeding on us can't transmit that disease anymore.
Okay.
Same as horses, but they can also be affected by West Nile virus.
And this is any bird? Any bird?
It generally tends to be species, corvid species, so crows, blue jays, any of the raptor families. That tends to be the most common.
Okay. All right. Well, what we're here to as well talk about tonight is the tire collection that's coming up. It's important, as you're stating, to remove those areas of breeding for the mosquito. That is the tire collection's coming up May 17th on Friday, and it is by appointment only. We collect both passenger car and large tire that are on large vehicles or tractors, and we've been doing this for 2 years. The importance of this process, too, is to call the Conservation District and set up the appointment, because it is by appointment only.
Correct.
Because of limited funding that both of our agencies have, but still, we understand the need for this to happen. So, when you call for the free tire collection, I have the telephone number here a couple of times. Please write it down, 610-372-4657, and that's the Conservation District office. By appointment only, no tires with rims, no businesses can participate. Must be free of dirt, water, foreign objects, and they can't be deformed in any way. Okay, they have to have the normal geometry of a typical tire. The passenger car limitation is 25 cars per household, maximum 35 inches, between 6 inches and 12 inches wide. But again, the appointments are necessary in order to have this drop-off site. For the passenger tire, we have them delivered to drop them off at the Ag Center. And we have help there to do it, to unload your vehicle and stack them up. And that's how we have to put them in the semi, so we can get as many in there and so they don't fall over and roll around. For the large tractor tires, we have them delivered to or dropped off at Allegheny Towing. And the reason behind that is, the equipment. They have the equipment there to handle it. We do not out at the Ag Center. So, again, it's best to contact the Berks County Conservation District and set up an appointment. In 2017, we collected over 3,025 tires, so that's about 130,000 pounds. 2018, as you see, we had another big year. So, in total, we've collected over 5,400 tires. And if I use the multiplication there, if you're saying over 10,000 adult mosquitoes per tire, we could eliminate over 54 million mosquitoes there. So that's just fantastic. I think that's the best way of trying to take care of this issue is to have this event. So once we collect the tires then, the company that we work with, Mahantongo, they take them and then chop them up or use them for other uses, which again is another perfect way of recycling and putting those tires to good use. And that's why they have to be clean and clear of foreign objects, because they are used for playground material, mm-hmm. Interlocking landscape borders and things like that. So again, puts a good use to this program. So we appreciate you coming in this evening and sharing your knowledge about what you're doing as far as keeping our community safe and clean, and to work with you with this tire program again this year. I'm very excited. We will leave the telephone number of the Conservation District up afterwards, so you can call and set up an appointment. The city has its own tire collection, and that is run through the Solid Waste Authority, Kevin Lugo, so folks in the city can give him a call and set it up as well. So I thank you for watching this evening. I thank you for coming in and sharing your knowledge. I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Sure thing. So this has been County Connection, and thank you for joining us.